It's 3:31 p.m. on Monday the 25th of March 2019. We're live somewhere on the A1M in North Yorkshire, and this is the Cattle Whiskers Podcast, CarCast, live. Hello and welcome to the A1M and a lovely little red Suzuki as we travel south back from a Scottish doubleheader weekend. I'm Jono Bullard, and with me in this perfect place of transport are the driver, Tina Taylor.
Hiya, my car appreciates the praise.
Adam Reddish.
Hi everyone.
And last but not least, Paul Balm.
Hiya, you trying to get out of paying for petrol?
Already paid. So we're going to be looking back on Panthers Scottish doubleheader weekend, a game against the Clan on Saturday and the Fife Flyers on Sunday. Some of the more important details of the EIHL, including the title race and the race for the final playoff spot. And then we've also got your comments and questions that you sent us over the weekend before looking ahead to the final game of the regular season against the Guildford Flames at the NIC on Saturday. But we're going to start way back on Saturday night at the Into Brayhead Arena as Panthers took on the Glasgow Clan. Put my teeth in. The Glasgow Clan and came away with a 4-0 regulation victory. Panther scorers were John Rowe on the power play in the first period.
A power play goal!
Dylan Richard in the second period, and then a Luke Pither double in the third period, the final one of which a short-handed effort. A 4-0 win. And Paul, it was a very, very good performance.
It was. I thought, to be honest, towards the end it was a fairly easy win, but you know, we came out and we played well. We rode a luck a little bit in the first period. Bray had Glasgow, I knew I'd do it eventually. Had some decent shots. Quite how they claimed they had 16 shots to our 6, I don't know. But you know, we got the one that counted. You know, we scored. They didn't score any of this. So that's what you want. But yeah, you know, a good all round performance. I thought defensively we were sound. Glasgow didn't throw too much at us, but despite the 16 shots, but we stood up to it, and you know, we played a lot better, you know, as well as I've seen us play for a while now.
And Tina, as good as Panthers were, Glasgow were very poor. Apart from probably the opening 5 or 6 minutes, they didn't really show anything much at all during that game. And one of the things we commented on Saturday night was Zach Fitzgerald. He was hardly noticeable.
Yeah, if anybody can locate Zach Fitzgerald or Brendan Connolly's nads, can you let us know, please? Because both of them were absolutely absent for a large majority of Saturday night's performance, quite frankly. Yeah, I mean, one of the things I tweeted on the night was, you know, where the heck is Zach Fitzgerald? I mean, there's, you know, one or two Panthers players busy ragdolling Connolly around because he was doing what he does. You know, he's a wind-up merchant, and you know, he's sort of our clan's answer to Robert Farmer, I suppose, in a way. And there was just nothing from anybody to, you know, to protect Connolly. You know, nobody was standing up for him. You know, there was no Adam Keefe to his Darryl Lloyd kind of thing. You know, and you would have kind of expected that he would have had some backup, but there was absolutely nothing. But yeah, and I mean, in terms of the actual performance from the Clan, it was a bit lacklustre. You know, I mean, I think, you know, Graham Thompson from Purple Army podcast, he said they've had something like 3 wins in 10 since they won the Conference Trophy, which I may have my figures wrong, but it's a disappointing statistic however you look at it. They've not won much since they got a trophy, which, you know, as we've said many times on this podcast, it's not an important one, frankly. You know, we don't see it as an important one. Apologies, Clan fans, if you feel differently about it, but it's certainly not one that, you know, we sort of herald much for being in our trophy cabinet. And yeah, it just did feel a little bit sort of, well, you know, we're just kind of coasting a bit, and you know, we're just trying to get ourselves you know, keep ourselves in playoffs, and you know, but you know, we're going to be in playoffs, so you know, we'll just see where we end up, rather than sort of going, look, you know, we could absolutely you know, run Panthers for that third spot, guarantee a home seeding, you know, a home advantage, and you know, put ourselves in the best position possible. It did sort of feel like there was very little resistance from them in general.
Adam, you wanted to come in?
Oh no, I was just putting my finger up to suggest that I think Clan have won one game out of the last 10 rather than 3. But yeah, I mean, what other people have said is pretty much bang on really about the game. You know, for all of the good positive things that the Panthers did on Saturday night, which was welcome from fans' perspectives, I don't really think they met much resistance in Clan. I thought Clan were very lethargic. Really strange, because you know, it was a big crowd there, pretty much a sellout. I thought they might have wanted to, you know, entertain their fans, but credit to Panthers. I thought, you know, after that early onslaught, if it was quite as bad as an onslaught on our net, I thought we controlled the rest of the game really well, and you know, kept shots pretty minimal, and Munson didn't have a great deal of work to do that was of a challenging nature, but you know, it was a perfect road game, I think, from Panthers' perspective. You know, looked fairly dangerous on occasions and scored goals at regular intervals to like peg back any hopes that Clan might have had to get back in the game.
Paul, one of the big turning points of the third period was Peter Russell called a timeout with, I think, 7 or 8 minutes left in the game when it was 3-0 to the Panthers. And I think I said to you at the time, I wonder if he's looking at maybe taking Rumpole out of the net for the extra attacker early on to try and just get something back from the game. They go and get a power play, don't get the chance to get Rumpole off, and then Luke Pither scores shorthanded.
Yeah, I mean, we'll never know now, I guess, because all that happened. But they needed to get a goal, I think. I mean, a 3-0 down, you know, you make it 2-0, all of a sudden you've got a chance, especially if you pull the keeper who knows what you can do, because you know, that would have been the 2 points for them Saturday night, would, you know, would have been a big step towards them getting third. As it is, you know, they've slipped, but they can't get third, I don't think, now. So you know, that opportunity was missed, but it was a lovely goal by Pither, lovely sort of backhand to roof it past Rumpel, probably the best of the goals on the night. I mean, we talked about, you know, what Munson had to do. There was one first period I really don't know how it didn't go in from the angle we got, which was obviously the other end of the ring. But I didn't think Rumpel had a great game. He definitely won Rose first back. They just went through his five hole, but that one of Pither was, you know, practically unstoppable.
And a first professional shutout for Patrick Munson. Turned away all of the 37 shots that he faced. And guys, it was a pretty solid performance from the Panthers netminder.
Yeah, well, sorry, is this it? when you said guys, I'm sorry, I can't see where that's being pointed, because I'm trying to concentrate on the road. But there we go. It was a bit of an odd one. Munson started, I mean, you know, sort of for reasons that became obvious later on in the weekend, but yeah, I mean, he saw everything, and I think there were one or two points when he had you know, some quick fire shots to save, which is why the shot count was so high, because I think we came to the end of the first period and we were quite surprised at the amount of shots that had gone on Munson, if I remember correctly. But yeah, he had a good game. I mean, what more can you say? Is when he's been called upon, he's not done too bad. I mean, you know, for his first professional season, you know, he's had a solid go. I mean, he's not had regular starts. But so yeah, because he's been backing up Michael Garnett. But when he's been in, he's been all right. You know, he's a good netminder. I think he's got potential to be, you know, a really good netminder. But yeah, I must admit, bit of a surprise to see him start on Saturday. You know, not knowing what we know now, I think.
Okay, we shall leave Saturday's game there and move on to Sunday as Panthers travelling to Kirkcaldy to take on the Fife Flyers. Fife coming away with a 4-3 overtime victory. Their goals coming from Crowder, Bazzara, Finucci and Basaraba with the overtime winner just 13 seconds before the end of overtime. Panthers goals coming from Ollie Betteridge, John Rowe and Alex Guptill. Flyers were 2-0 and 3-1 up in the game. But Paul, was that one more point than we expected?
It was three more points than I expected across the weekend. But I think it was. And I think before the game, it was one more than it was more than I expected. And I think certainly end of the first period, it was more than I expected. Because Five came at us. They played a really good game, and we looked second best.
Yeah. Adam, Michael Garnett was pulled after the third Fife goal, and some Panthers fans have been getting on his back. We'll probably come to that a little later. But was he surprised that Garnett got pulled at that point with 2 minutes still left in the first period?
Yeah, it was a strange time, I think, to see him pulled. I mean, yes, the third goal was his fault and he'd won it back every day of the week, but I don't think the first two goals were Mike Garnett's fault at all. They were good goals, well taken by Fife, so I think it was a little harsh to see him go, although obviously we know now that he wasn't particularly well over the weekend. And that might have had a factor and been a bit of an issue in the timing of when he departed last night. But I didn't think he was bad. You know, some netminders concede three on like five or six shots, and you think they're just not in the game at all. They can't see the puck, they're fighting it, and they've had a bit of a nightmare. I didn't think that was the case last night with Garnett. I think, if anything, the players in front of him failed him. And it seemed that there was a real sort of sea change in the way the team played after Munson replaced Garnett between the pipes. And that's unfortunate for Garnett, really. You think that if Garnett wasn't particularly well in himself, that the team might have made a bit more of a concerted effort to limit the number of shots and try to get the traffic away from his net. But obviously that wasn't the case, and it led to Garnett being pulled when that third Fife goal went in.
Yeah, sorry, I just wanted to come in on that because I have a little bit of an issue with the decision making that put Mike Garnett on the ice on Friday. If he's not well, if he's not 100%,
Friday.
Oh my good God, I'm blaming the vodka.
Not
right now. Please don't send any police out to breathalyse me because it's really not necessary. I've had several cups of tea today to try. Anyway. Last night, Sunday, if he's not well over the weekend and we're going into a playoff run, we're trying to get ourselves in the best position to get ourselves to final four, home advantage and all the rest of it, then why take him? Why even dress him? Why not? If you're going to give Munson the start on Saturday and he's proved himself to be the hot goalie, give him the start on Sunday. And I know for a fact Sam Gospel was there because I walked past him in Fife Ice Arena. So why not dress Gospel as the backup? It just seems like a really bizarre... I can well understand that Mike Garnett sort of said, I want to be involved. I want to help the team. I want some game time. But if he's not 100%, he shouldn't be there. That's a team decision that has to be made. That's a leadership decision that has to be made for the good of the team. So, I well understand that Mike Garnett probably... wanted to be involved, wanted to play, but if he's not 100% at this point in the season, when we've only got the one trophy left to play for, then he needs to sit out until he is 100%. And we've got a perfectly good British netminder who can who can dress, who can jump in if necessary. That whole decision just leaves me a little bit baffled, if I'm honest.
Paul, I'm going to come back to you because you were a little annoyed by. Well, more than a little annoyed by some of the chanting that took place after the first goal had been conceded.
Was it the first goal?
It was the first goal, yeah.
As soon as the goal went in, there were some Panthers fans at the back of our block chanting Patrick Munson's name, and I just thought, well, I thought it was a bit disrespectful, but I just thought it's ridiculous. You know, we're 1-0 down, we're against a team as good as five, to suddenly be trying to undermine your netminder by chanting the name of another one just because you like him, just because he does funny little dances and waves at the crowd. Then I just don't get why you do that. But are they the same ones who got up in the middle of the game in Brea just so they could go and get the picture taken with a bloke in a cow suit?
Yep.
Well, says it all, really, doesn't it?
Yeah. Also the same fans who, if anybody says anything negative towards the Panthers, are very quick to jump on their back, yet quite happy to chant about the netminder.
They want to practice what they preach.
Strikes me as slightly hypocritical, to be honest.
Yeah, practice what you preach, that's what I say.
Also, another couple of things from that game. Steve Lee, who got involved in a fight, reports are that he does have a broken jaw. He went to hospital during the game and didn't return to the game, obviously, and it looks like he is now probably done for the season if a broken jaw does turn out to be the case, Adam.
Yeah, it didn't look good, did it? And I mean, obviously, a broken jaw depends on the severity of it. You might see him again before the end of the season wearing a full face cage, possibly, but it depends on how much discomfort is in during a game. It's a blow for us. You know, you'd never want to lose a player like Steve Lee, but at this time of the season, when you're wanting to get some momentum to go into the post-season playoffs, it's an even bigger loss. And I'm sure, as we'll talk about in a few minutes' time, the defensive core is stretched as it is at the moment without, you know, losing another player to injury. So, yeah, it's a big blow for us. I mean, Steve Lee's a dependable D-man. You know what you get with him. And they're the sort of guys that you want in the team at this stage of a season. But you know, it's never a nice thing to see any player suffer an injury like that. And I think, unfortunately, he just was on the receiving end of a very, very good punch from Bulmer that, you know, connected very sweetly. So, yeah, it's a shame really for Steve Lee. And, you know, as well as Panthers, I just hope that he's not missing as well from the World Championship campaign for GB at the end of the season, because that really would be a massive blow for him. I mean, we've heard him say how much, you know, he's been looking forward to being involved in that tournament at the season's end. So, you know, from a personal point of view for him, I'm sure it'd be a massive, massive blow if he missed out on that trip.
And another thing from the weekend as a whole is the fact that Justin Kovacs didn't ice at all and was down as a healthy scratch. No word of an injury.
He wasn't downed as a healthy scratch. On both, I think on both the Panthers' tweets on each night, it just said scratches. But there was no, I mean, it did say that Hazeldine was an injury scratch, but it didn't actually specify either way about Kovac, which I find very interesting.
Yeah, it seems that he's very much out of favour at the minute. I think he's only recently played the home game against Dundee. Other times he has been left out in favour of having two important netminders on the bench, and we know Kovacs can score a few goals. He has run dry, certainly in the second half of the season, but
he's hardly alone in that.
Yeah, true. Is it a surprise that he didn't feature at all this weekend, especially if he was fit?
I really don't know. You know, we're obviously not privy to things that happen within the club. They might be out of favour. Might be carrying a bit of a knock, we don't know. Maybe we don't want to risk him if he's carrying a slight knock of some nature. It's difficult to sort of discuss it, to be honest, but I suppose if you look at his form over the entirety of the season, he's you know, blown hot and cold. As Paul said, you know, he's not the only forward that's gone through those sorts of peaks and troughs over the course of the season. Personally, I've been disappointed with him. I think he could have offered more. Again, other forwards that we've got could have offered more as well. So I don't think he's any worse or any better than the likes of Hurtubise in that regard. So, yeah, we really don't know why he was missing, I guess. But sort of sums up the season, really, where we're having these conversations about why players are missing. You know, is it through form, is it through injury? If it was through form, I'd suggest that you could probably have sat about four of our import forwards this year all at the same time.
Another controversial incident in this game, Jaden Risling receiving a 5-plus game misconduct for checking to the head in a tussle with Barry McKenzie of the Flyers. McKenzie is face down on the ice and Jaden Risling cross-checks him in the back of the head. Considering that Steve Lee had left the ice at this point, a bit of a petulant, stupid penalty to take.
Oh yeah, you just described it in two words. It was ludicrous. I mean, yeah, I can see why being wrestled to the ground by Barry McKenzie would irritate you, but to then do that, knowing the situation you're in, is, it's not really stupid. It's showing a certain amount of contempt for your team and your teammates, because this is what another check into the head penalty for him. He's down on with Dops already as a repeat offender. So I wouldn't be surprised if we don't see Risling again this season, or quite frankly, I also wouldn't be bothered if we didn't see him at all, because if you're going to have a team, I'm all for teams that play hard, but there's playing hard and there's doing stupid things like that. There was nothing hard about that. Just to change very briefly, I mean, I've been giving Urgeby's dogs abuse for weeks, but he probably threw the best check of the weekend.
Yeah, it was beautiful, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. Mark Hurtubise threw the best check of the weekend. That's not what we've signed him for. But, you're about Kovacs. I'd have, if he's out of form, sorry, if he's out of favour now, he's not going to get many games if we're having to deal with Risling's ban as well.
Yeah, I mean, we all agreed that it was an absolutely fair enough penalty. Being a game misconduct, Dops will look at that. Can either you, Tina, Adam, see Risling playing again this season?
Not a chance. Like Paul says, the repeat offender tag is absolutely going to knacker him. Had he not got those previous incidents against him, then maybe you could be looking at a game or two, and you might see him. You might see him for playoff final weekend if we got there, but nah, repeat offender tag, I'm expecting maybe four or five games, and so that's his season done for me.
I think his car's marked. Dops have investigated Risling's actions before. We know those incidents quite well, but you know, Dops aren't going to be too interested in the sort of circumstances around those. I think they're just going to judge this incident, and I think that it was a reckless thing for him to do. It was petulant, it was a spontaneous thing, but sometimes you've just got to, you know, put that to the back of your mind and do what's right for the team. And you know, he didn't help us last night during the remainder of the game. He certainly won't help us during the remainder of what's left of the season if Dops do chuck the book at him and assess him a multi-game penalty, which does finish his season off. So yeah, it was a very selfish thing to do, and it annoyed me. It really did annoy me, because I think Paul said a minute or two ago that it just showed a lack of respect and a disregard for his teammates out there last night, and he's really put Panthers at a disadvantage now. I mean, our defences are going to be stretched. If Lee is out for the rest of the season, we've got to drop Henderson back on there on the blue line, then that's not ideal. He's not a natural D-man at all, and you know, other teams will be able to capitalise on that. So it's really sort of messed around with the whole structure of our defence, and it massively compromised our ability to win the one remaining trophy of the year.
Okay, we're going to move on to one of the questions that we've received. We've had a few from Gareth, who is at Fogey on Twitter, but this relates to this, and he says, Risling's lack of discipline, is it a problem or a fan-pleasing asset?
Paul? Well, it's a problem. Because having a player sitting out games, going to the penalty box for games, for stupid things like that, doesn't win you games. It's like the Munson and always great because he dances about. You don't sign players because they dance about. Or at least you shouldn't do. So, yeah, I mean, I've seen people saying, oh, he shouldn't get a ban for it. He's going to get a ban. you know, in ways it was worse than the Mosey incident.
Well, the Mosey incident was a hockey play. That was a genuine hockey play. This was dirty.
Yeah, exactly. That, you know, that's what I mean. There was the intent there last night to do that. So, I mean, who knows? You could get it'd be a ban that would just see him to the end of the season. But what if they ban him into next? Does that then affect us next season as well?
Yeah, and it affects where if he returns to the Elite League, it will affect whoever he plays for. Yeah. So I suppose we have to see what the Dops ban hammer comes down with that one. But I don't think it's going to be light. I think it's going to be very harsh. As you say, it will be his third check to the head penalty. So I can see multi games for that. Unfortunately, just before we leave this game, got to pay a lot of credit to the Five Flyers. A beautiful, beautiful overtime winner. Just 13 seconds from time. It was really taken very, very well by Basaraba. Right at the top of the crease. He's got very little net to aim at. Munson making himself big and he finds the roof of the net. It was a great finish.
Quality finish. Bit heartbreaking for us given the lateness in the overtime period, and that we were probably all resigned for penalties and maybe looking at getting that second point. But yeah, I mean, what a great finish by Basaraba to elevate the puck there. You've got to have good hands to do that, and it was unfortunate for Munson really, because he'd done well, a bit lucky when he went between the pipes to take over from Garnett. I think we had a couple of referee reviews, official reviews, to see whether the puck had crossed the line or not. I think once the puck had hit the post and the other time the puck had hit the bar. But, yeah, Fife certainly had some good chances and opportunities on our net. And, sadly, they managed to get one just past Munson with the last shot of the game.
Just before we leave that, another question that comes from Gareth at Fogey in regards Patrick Munson. Is Patrick Munson good enough to be our number one netminder? He has a better save percentage than Michael Garnett. Tina?
Not yet. You have to remember as well that Munson's... The amount of games that Munson has played is a lot less than Michael Garnett. So, you know, Mike Garnett has a lot more minutes on the ice and, you know, a lot more potential for goals going past him. But that being said, I think Munson has got potential to be a very good netminder, but I don't think at this point he is quite ready for the number one spot, for given the aspirations that that we have for the Panthers team and the demands that certainly the fan base that have got the years of service, if you will, equal or more than the people in this car, aspire to. So, he's definitely got potential, but I don't think he is quite the number one that we need just yet.
I mean, personally speaking, for me, I like Munson. I think, like you say, Tina, he has a lot of potential.
Sorry, yeah. Before I forget, and before the traffic gets any more interested, Patrick Munson makes a connection with fans that the rest of the team do not, and I think that's one of the things that the fan base have picked up on, and it's an endearing quality. So I think that's why there are so many calls to re-sign him. Because I'm sorry, I'm probably going to steal this one off Paul, because you said it earlier, Paul. You know, last night, when it came to overtime, as he's going he's gone to the bench, and as he's skating back to the net, he's lifting his glove hand, is it to the crowd, to the Panthers fans, to say, come on, make some noise, get involved, get invested, get behind the team, sort of thing. And he was the only one that did that. And I'll be honest, I don't remember any other Panthers players doing that this season, frankly. So that's one thing about Munson that I think is really sort of, leading the calls for everybody to have him re-signed, because he's made a connection with the fans.
And like I said, for me, I think he does have potential. I don't think he's good enough to be a number one netminder at the Panthers just yet. I wouldn't be averse to him coming back as a backup in import netminder next season if that's the way that Panthers want to go. But at the moment, and this is the vital question for me, would Patrick Munson win us games in the way that Ben Bounds and Tyler Besco-Rowani have won games for Cardiff and Belfast?
I don't think he would, to be honest. No. He's young. And there are still aspects of his game that need work. I'm not going to mention them on here because you never know who's going to be listening. Paul Dixon's listening to this. I'm not writing his team talk. Those aspects I need to work on, and if I can spot them, then you can guarantee the coaches of other teams can spot them, so they'll know how to work him. But so that in the game in Braehead, he rode his luck. There was one in the first period, I have no idea how it didn't go in the net, but it didn't, and he just doesn't give me that level of confidence. You know, there's no feeling that I know he's going to save that. I know he's going to save that. And sometimes Garnett doesn't as well. But you're never entirely sure about him.
Okay. Anyone else want to come in on that about Munson possibly being number one?
I don't think so. I agree with the others. I think he's raw. There are aspects of his game, because he's raw, that endear him to the fans. And, you know, he can make great saves. He can make good recovery saves because of his flexibility and his mobility. You know, he's a young guy, which, you know, Garnett might not be able to do at his stage of his career. But I think, like Paul was just saying there, you always feel there's a real rookie mistake in him, which is inevitable at his stage of career. You know, he's still learning, still finding out about pro hockey. But his positioning for me sometimes leaves a little bit of a question mark over him. I don't think sometimes he sets up correctly for a shooter. I mean, we've seen occasionally, you know, he gets pulled from side to side a bit easily. I think he's an aggressive netminder. He likes to challenge the shooter or, you know, the puck carrier if someone's got the puck close to his net on either side of it. And that's quite brave as a netminder to, you know, be that sort of aggressive, because you do leave space behind you, and you might get guys, you know, just making quick passes and tapping it into an empty net. We've seen that against Munson already this season. So there is potential there, though. I think he is a good netminder in making, but he could probably do with a bit of coaching, to be honest. And that's the problem in this country. You know, teams aren't that well financed or resourced to all have individual netminder coaches. I mean, some have, but not all do. And I don't think we do as a club. So, you know, will he sort of learn and develop his game here? He's probably learned a lot, you know, being second fiddle to Garnett. You know, I'm sure he's taken lots of advice and ideas from Garnett as the season's gone on. But for me at the moment, no, I don't think he's quite ready to become a starting netminder for Panthers.
We had a great question coming from Sarah Atwood on Twitter. Hello to you, Sarah, if you're listening. It says, Garnett's form dips when he's challenged by the number two. Thoughts? And I suppose a similar thing happened last season when Patrick Galbraith came in and he did take over the number one spot and was the favoured netminder, and certainly in the second half of last season. Any feelings on Sarah's question there about that?
Maybe he just doesn't like people called Patrick. But no, I mean, seriously, I'm not sure. I think definitely last season it did, and how well Galbraith was playing had the effect on it. But I don't think until perhaps last night, and we've established that he may well have not been well, I don't think his form's dipped that much. He's been one of the players, I think, that's been playing better than his teammates.
Okay. We shall move on to the rest of the EIHL news, and we're going to concentrate really on the title race and the race for eighth place. So the title race started on Friday night. Storm with a fantastic 5-2 victory over the Giants. which gave a big advantage to the Cardiff Devils, who played on Saturday against same opposition, and they shut out the Storm at the Viola Arena with a 4-0 victory to give them a 6-point cushion in the title race. However, Sunday saw it turn around again, the Giants beating the Sheffield Steelers 5-1, and then the Devils travelling to Dundee to take on the Stars, losing 3-1. So, Devils with a 4-point cushion, Giants with a game in hand against Coventry, which will take place this Wednesday. So, Adam Mortino, who wants to come in on this, is it still too late, or is there life in this title race yet?
It's very, very interesting. You know, I mean, I'm aware that there are a few Cardiff Devil fans that actually made a special trip up to Dundee just in case. Coventry are very all of a sudden very important in this title race, but they're also very important in the last bit of playoff place. You know, it's just it's very interesting. It's a shame we're not involved in it. it's a shame. It's a massive, massive shame we're not talking about this from the inside, and you know, we're just sort of, you know, casual spectators. And you know, hello third. So it might as well be eighth, frankly. But there you go. But yeah, it's fascinating because Coventry could be kingmakers. You know, they could deal with Belfast on Wednesday, and Cardiff then, you know, become de facto champions without actually having to do anything.
So, well, Coventry also take on the Devils next Sunday. So
exactly. So it could go that close. I mean, you know, Coventry and Cardiff's rivalry is, you know, I mean, obviously a little bit one-sided in recent years, but it certainly can be a heated one. And it's an interesting game for both Coventry and Cardiff to finish their regular season on. So, it's very, very interesting how it's all ended up playing out.
I think Cardiff will still do it. I know things have taken a little twist with the outcome of the weekend's games, and it's now in the balance again, but I think probability points me towards thinking that Cardiff will get the job done. I think it would be a real collapse if they folded now and handed the title to Belfast. I just think with the way that the coaching is at Cardiff, I don't think Andrew Lord would let them slip up. I know they dropped the game yesterday to Dundee. They wouldn't have wanted that, of course, for obvious reasons, but you know, that defeat, I think, would have just jolted them a bit and made everyone refocus on the job in hand, which, you know, is to secure that last win, really, that will probably be good enough for them. So, but it's good to see the Elite League go to the wire. Like Tina said, it's a shame that it's a two-horse race for the top spot, and we're a very, very, very distant third. And but, you know, it's all you can ask for in terms of entertainment and, you know, the competitiveness, even if it's just the two teams at the top who are competitive and fighting each other and pushing each other hard. But, yeah, I reckon that 8 or 9 times out of 10, Cardiff win from this position.
OK. After the weekend, there is just one playoff place left. That'll go to whoever finishes in 8th, and that's currently a battle between 3 teams. The Blaze hold that position at the moment, 58 points with 3 games left. The Storm are 9th on 57 points with 2 games left, and the Dundee Stars 56 points with 2 games left. So Paul, it is advantage Blaze, especially having the most games, but it still could go to any one of those 3 teams.
It could, and you know, as we've just been saying, Blaze have got a fairly difficult running.
Yeah, I mean, Belfast and Cardiff, yeah.
So, yeah, you'd probably say they're in the pole position right now, but I wouldn't put my money on any one of the 3. Mm. It really is too close to call. Somebody just gets, you know, a couple of good games, nicks a couple of results, they're there. Mm. Maybe not, but we will see.
Anybody want to stick their neck out and say who'll get that 8th place?
Well, Dundee must feel quite confident, you know, for their remaining games after beating Cardiff last night. So, don't want to stick my neck out. I think it's really tricky. It's difficult to predict who's going to get that final playoff place. Twists and turns still to pan out. But it's exciting. Again, we're looking at it from a different perspective in third. I'm glad we're not down in eighth, because it really would have been a catastrophic season if we'd been in the hunt for that final place.
Tina?
I don't think it'll be Dundee, if I'm honest. I think it's Manchester and Blaise. Now, Manchester have got the better run in, but Coventry have obviously got that third game that could make all the difference. I mean, if they win it, not only do they put themselves in a better position for their eighth place, but you know, that gives Cardiff the title. So, you know, that settles a lot of things if they win that game on Wednesday. But yeah, I think Dundee have left themselves a little bit too much to do. I know it's only 2 points between them and Coventry, but I just think it's just that little hurdle too much for me. So I think it's between Storm and Blaze, frankly.
Okay, we'll leave the Elite League there and move on to some of the questions and comments that you've left us over the past few days. We asked for comments on how you feel about Panthers' season. Joe Balm says, shambolic. I have never watched a more inconsistent team play. They can play well one night and be like they haven't got a clue the next. No offensive flair, devoid of characters or passion, and far too lazy. It's baffling how we're third. And another comment from Richard Bradley, who just simply asks, how are we third? And I suppose to add to that, we are in third place. Okay, we are 20 odd points behind the leaders, which is not where we want to be. But does that point to how inconsistent other teams have been, when we are in essence ahead of Cardiff and Belfast, who have been far better than everybody else? We seem to top that best of the rest. Anyone?
It is interesting that it's been a two-horse race for a number of weeks for the title, and yeah, I still don't understand. I don't understand how we're third. You know, we've had what feels like the worst season in about the last, you know, three or four, but still that's the highest league position that we've attained. Well, sorry, Johnny, I'm a right thief today. I'm stealing this one off you. But yeah, this the highest league position we've attained since we won the league title. So it just doesn't make any sense. It speaks to a lot of consistency with Cardiff and Belfast, but everybody else has just been marvellously mediocre, really. That's where the points have gone to Cardiff and Belfast, and everybody else has just been scratching around for the leftovers, I suppose.
And I think a lot of people involved in the Elite League, players and coaches, quite often mention that they feel that this year is probably the most competitive Elite League. And I suppose if you take Belfast and Cardiff out of the equation, then yeah, that sort of holds true. We are the best of the rest. I don't really understand how we've got to third. I think it's probably a quirk of where all the fixtures were sort of played, because there's been times where we were, you know, miles ahead of some of the other teams in terms of the games that we'd already taken part in. But it's not like we've had a really stirring surge at the end of the season to get into third either. And that's what I don't understand. It's other teams, Clan, Flyers, who, and Guildford as well, who a few weeks ago, if they would have actually maybe played, say, 600 hockey or better, they would have knocked us down into fifth or sixth. But that just hasn't happened. And they've, you know, all gone on bad runs of their own and, you know, had some slumps. And, you know, we've sort of, like, limped into third by some miracle. It's a difficult one. I agree with what Joe's saying. You know, the Panthers this year has just been infuriating in terms of the consistency, and quite frankly the hockey's just not been very exciting. It's been dull, it's been attritional. You know, many of the accusations that were laid in, you know, Corey Nielsen's door for the last two or three years about, you know, unambitious hockey and, you know, the staleness of you know, how we play offensively, you could certainly label that at both Chernomaz's and in the latter stages of the season Rick Strachan's doorstep this year, because the hockey has been boring. And I think that's had a big sort of impact on this impasse between quite a large degree of the fan base and the team, because there's just been very little worth getting excited about or anything interesting to watch on a Saturday night.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I mean, me and Paul had a conversation earlier in the season in bunkers after one of the games where you could take the losses if you'd actually enjoyed watching the game. But there's just like Adam says, there's not been a lot to get excited about. We seem to have built a team that was going to give us exciting hockey, if nothing else, and we just didn't get it. So, you know, we weren't getting the wins, we weren't being entertained at the games, we weren't, you know, coming out of the NIC feeling particularly excited. So what the hell have we got?
It's a characterless team. You know, we talked earlier about Munson and some of his antics and theatrics, you know, trying to G up the crowd or celebrating goals, etc. But, you know, other than that, it's just such a bland, stale team. There's no character, there's no personalities on it, and it's made for very, very boring and dour hockey this season. And the sooner it's over, the better, as far as I'm concerned, and we can just totally wipe the slate clean, you know, get a new coach in place for next season, and let's build a more exciting team that can sort of sustain it, and also can, you know, reconcile that break between some of the fans and the club as a whole, because I think certainly the second half of the season that's been growing and growing, and if that's not you know, healed in some way, then that can fester and do a lot of damage to an organisation. So we need to have a better season next year. I know that goes without saying, but you know, we can't afford to be 20 points back again next season for whoever's above us in the table. We've got to be in there, we've got to be fighting the league title until, you know, 2-3 games from the end of the season, hopefully with a view to being in that title race and winning one for ourselves, because it's been long overdue.
At 46233 underscore Sam on Twitter, he says, far from the worst performances of the season, but even though we're playing half decent leading up to the playoffs, shouldn't cover the fact that major changes are needed off and on the ice come the end of the season.
I think he's just agreeing with what Adam Tina just said. Yeah. So, to be honest, I think you were saying to me, oh, we're going to this question next. I'm thinking, but they're just answering it now. Yeah, I can't really add anything. We do need a change. The number of players I'd keep from this season, you could count on one hand, and that's probably one hand that's been mauled in a shark attack. But, yeah, it's, I mean, Adam talked about it, the hockey being attrition. I think most of the attrition's been on us. We do need changes. It's going to have to be root and branch. Neil Black talked the other week about, you know, the team has lost their identity. I don't even think the team knows what their identity is anymore. I mean, I certainly don't. I mean, what this question follows: what is our identity?
Oh God!
Mm.
We're
going to
have a whole podcast on that.
Well, it is a good point. Cats Whiskers TV on Twitter, let us know what you think. What is the Nottingham Panthers' identity?
And if you support another team and want to say we're a bunch of losers, we already know that, all right? Yeah.
Antoine Marie-Jean, who sent this... yeah, for name sounds familiar. He sent this actually after our last podcast on Friday. And he says, how much of the apathy currently is down to the Panthers versus how the game in this country is going? Example, less physicality.
Well, let me just refer you to one of my previous statements. You know, Rich Schoenematz apparently built a team that was going to play physical hockey, and as soon as the pre-season was wrapped up, we didn't really see it. So, you know, that... Yeah, fine, you know, we were taking penalties early on in the season, but, there, you know, it is possible to play physical and not take penalties. Mark Hurtubise showed that with his belter of a hit last night. So it's possible. So you sign players who can come in to do that job and sustain it, like we've already mentioned earlier on in this very podcast. It's, you know, you can have a physical team. And if you can't guarantee building a team that's going to, you know, outscore the opposition every game then you build a team that can wear the other team down, like what Schoenematz said, you know, his team were going to do. So it's possible to still keep the physicality, and I would like to see that, because, you know, we're not known for the Nottingham Panthers that I've watched since the departure of David Alexander Beauregard, and, you know, title winning year aside, we've not really ever been known for having you know a team that scores a massive amount of goals. So we may as well have a team that can wear the opposition down, and you know maybe we can win goals win games by a goal or two, because that'll do me. I want, you know, if we're not going to win, I want to be entertained, and you know it's not a difficult equation for me.
Well, the problem is this year we've not been winning and we've not been entertained.
Exactly. Well, so.
and I think that in a nutshell is probably where the apathy from a lot of Panthers fans this season has stemmed from. I mean, Tina's right. A lot of fans would like to see that perfect blend of physicality and finesse. You know, we want to see guys that can look after their own backs and can, you know, throw pretty solid checks, either mid-ice or around the boards. But then we want to see guys that have got, you know, good hands and skill and can make things happen offensively. You know, it's a magic formula. You know, every coach of the elite league is trying to find that perfect formula. But I think because we keep getting it wrong, you've got to ask why we keep getting it wrong. You know, the coaches keep making the wrong decisions, recruitment's wrong. I think the new era that we were promised this year has fell flat on its face after about a third of the season. And the same problems just seem to happen on a, you know, cyclical basis. And there just needs to be a lot of thought, I think, off the ice from the senior parts of the club and the organisation about what the Panthers stand for. You know, do we want to be playing run-and-gun hockey for, you know, a 70-game season or whatever it is? Or do we want to be more attritional? I've nothing against attritional, tighter hockey if you're winning a lot more than you lose.
Scoring goals is fun, however you look at it.
Yeah, it is. But, you know, if you win games 3-1, 2-1, 2-0, that's great. You know, if you can do that throughout the course of a season, you'll be in the title hunt at the end of it.
Happy days.
And happy days. You know, the fans will be surely a lot happier than this nondescript, characterless hockey that we've seen for most of the 2019 season.
But going back to Ant's question... The only thing I'd ask, I mean, hockey is changing. The physicality, there is less physicality. How much apathy have Cardiff or Belfast fans got right for it right now?
Yeah, good point. Couple of questions left, which sort of will lead into our look ahead to the final game of the season against Guildford. At Sandy Blades, I believe he's a Steelers fan. Who do you think you'll play in the playoffs and who don't you want?
I really don't know. Was it anyone from three? Yeah. I'm really not bothered. We've shown this season we can lose to anybody. So I probably don't really want Sheffield, if I'm honest. Cause
yeah, they would
really
be the ones I wouldn't want.
Them. Really good at losing to them. So maybe... I don't know, but I don't know who we'll get.
Sheffield is still possible, but unlikely after their defeat last night. Adam?
I know it's statistically improbable to get Sheffield, but you know, I wouldn't really want to face them again because they've got previous for making light work of us this season. But then after that, I don't want to coin a cliche, but it is a bit of a lottery. You know, we can be great on any given night. We can be absolutely atrocious on any given night. So you just hope that we're great in the first leg and we can afford to be a little bit atrocious in the second leg and hope for the balance of two games that gets us to the playoff finals.
Tina.
Just come back on what Adam said. Sorry, Tina. It's something I said to my dad last night. He was talking about how inconsistent we are. I said, well, we're not really. Because we've been, last couple of weeks, we've been really good on Saturday and not as good on Sunday. So, like Adam says, let's hope we can sort of drag ourselves 3/4 of the way to the line and then limp the rest.
Tina?
Sorry, I was just distracted by a bit of an argument breaking out between a lorry and a van that's just cut him up. I would prefer it not to be Steelers because, like Adam says, they've got previous. It would just be sickening to lose to them again. I've had enough. They've got bragging rights on us for far too many seasons now, so I've had enough of that. I'll be honest. I like Guildford as a team, but again, they can beat us. It's entirely possible. And Fife again, they can beat us. It's not a pleasant journey all the way up to Fife.
Do we need to turn off here, Tina?
No, we're carrying on. You're all right. Okay. I've got there's method to my madness. Don't worry. I think the problem is am I right in thinking it could be Fife, Guildford, or Sheffield? Is that sort of where our
Fife, Guildford, but Fife still have a very slim chance of finishing third if they win all their three remaining games, and we lose to Guildford on Saturday.
Yeah, it's slim, but unlike. Anyway, but yeah, so Fife and Guildford are a fair distance away. Sheffield is just up the road, but again, for reasons already stated, I don't think we want to play them. So you've either got the team that you really don't want to lose against, or you really don't want to give them a 3 or 4 goal advantage coming back into your own barn, or you've got the long road trips. So I mean, it swings and roundabouts. I don't think it matters. I think once you hear the word playoffs, I think the imports just switch into a different gear. Fingers crossed. And I think it just means something else. I think playoffs, and especially the playoff final weekend, the way that we run it in this country, it's a different beast over here to what it is anywhere else. So, there is a certain magic to it that the Brits and the imports that have been with us for a while sort of appreciate. So I don't form wise I don't think it matters. I think it's going to be just flip a coin, because I think it will be that close.
Okay, looking ahead to Saturday, 7 p.m. at the NIC, the final regulation season game of the season against the Guildford Flames. What are we expecting from this one?
Who knows? I mean, really, really, who knows? It's on a Saturday. We've been doing quite well on Saturdays, which probably means we'll lose. I honestly don't know. That's the only thing I could say with any definite about this team is I don't know what's going to happen.
Anything from either of you, Bert?
Well, we need to be stepping up things for the playoffs, don't we? Worst thing is to have a really bad performance at home to Guildford, and then you find that you've got Guildford in the playoff series. Yeah. That's not going to go well if those combinations come about. Surely you just want to put on a good performance for your fans at home, last regular season game. Finish it on a bit of a high. It's been a pretty dreadful season, all being considered. So give the fans something to cheer about going into the playoff series with whoever it's against. So problem is, looks like we're going to be pretty short on the blue line. No Lee and strong possibility of no Risling. So again, we'll be sticking plasters over gaping wounds again and messing around with lines potentially, because Henderson's going to have to come off a forward line. So we'll see, but I'd like to think we'd be competitive and we'd do our best to win, but the fact that we've got to make running repairs to the roster at this late stage of the season isn't ideal by any stretch.
Yeah, I mean, we've already seen a message saying, somebody saying we lost last night as part of a strategic plan, which is ludicrous. When you're 3-1 down, if it's part of a strategic plan, you don't come back to make it 3-3, do you? But who knows, maybe there isn't some sort of plan. What am I saying?
Tina?
Well, Guildford's been an interesting series, because we took all the points out of their barn in the regular season, and they nearly took all the points out of ours. So we were a bunch of anti-homers, both teams.
And they gave us a bit of a shellacking in the playoff. Challenge Cup semi-final.
Yeah, just a little bit. So, yeah, I mean... I think that they did have a bit of a sort of sticky period of form over the last few weeks, where nothing seemed to be going right for them. But they're still there or thereabouts. They're a dangerous team, and they've got some absolutely belting players. And they seem to have the benefit of rotating their two import netminders, who neither one seems to have the definitive number one marker. So they're both. This is rotated well enough for them to be fairly fresh. So you don't know who you're preparing for. So that's an added little bonus here when it comes to Guildford. Yeah, but I mean, it would be interesting if we did get them in playoffs, and you know, we were able to prepare by playing them in the last game of the season. So, maybe that will work in our favour. Who knows? But I don't know. Depends what Panthers team shows up. Just to put another cliche in there. If they turn up motivated, and as you know, as has already been said, they want to give the fans something to cheer about, then you know, obviously, yeah, they will probably turn it on, and you know, we're hopefully we're in for a good result. But you know, if they sort of think, well, you know, it's job done now, we'll be all right. We're in third, nothing to play for, and you know, we'll just try and you know. Try and work on the damage limitation, you know, no more injuries, etc. It's difficult one to call, but I would like to see us take some points and have a good run up to the playoff season.
Okay, we've got one more comment here, and it also comes from Richard Bradley. Hang on a minute, I've just been handed breaking news, just been handed to me, a tweet coming from BBC Radio Nottingham Sport. Former Panthers and Great Britain forward David Clark has been inducted into the UK Ice Hockey Hall of Fame. Yeah, brilliant news, absolutely deserved. Congratulations, Clarky. A more than deserved honour for your fabulous career.
Is he doing anything on Saturday?
Or for the rest of the season, to be fair. Right, just to finish off, Richard Bradley had another semi-serious question, as he puts it. Would you want to lose to Guildford if it meant Steelers got Cardiff or Belfast in the quarters? Could I go for this one, please?
No, yeah.
Please. Right. I want Panthers to win every game, regardless of what the consequences are or what it means elsewhere. We shouldn't worry about other teams and who other teams are going to get in the playoffs. We have to worry about ourselves and us engineering a loss just so Sheffield get a more difficult semi-final or quarter-final. No, sorry, not in my makeup. And I know it was. You said it was semi-serious, Richard, but for me, absolutely not. I want us to go out on Saturday and do everything they can to win that game against the Guildford Flames, regardless of what it does to the playoff picture. Anybody else feel any differently?
One word answer from me: momentum.
Mm. Anyone else?
I think you just fight your own battles, and what happens elsewhere happens elsewhere. I think that's all you can do. I think the phrase is control the controllables.
Tina, anything?
No, not really. Stick a traffic cone in it and move on, mate.
Okay, and I think we shall leave it there. Thanks for joining us on these two special car casts we've had on Friday and today. All that remains from me to say is thank you very much to Tina Taylor.
TTFN.
Adam Reddish.
Bye, everybody.
Paul Balm.
It's been a lot calmer, this one, hasn't it?
Certainly has.
Yeah, you've not made as many mistakes, that's why. See you, everybody.
I just needed one more to get back on the bus. You like riding the bike, you know.
Yeah.
And from me, Jono Bullard, thank you very much for listening. We'll speak to you again soon. Until then, ta-ra.